This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Today we're going to be talking on Dreamland with Les Velez of the Opus Network. Opus is devoted to helping and abductees and informing them and also understanding what is happening to people. Les is very accomplished in this field and has been doing this for many years, as we'll find out. This is one of a series of Dreamlands we will have off and on over the next few months, concentrating on the abductions and the abduction phenomenon because of what's happening in the wider world of ufology with the David Grush revelations and what are, I think, quite certain to follow more. And we are at the point where we know now there are craft and materials out there and that are in the possession of the U.S. government and presumably also the Russians, the Chinese, and probably others. We also know that Grush has suggested that there are bodies, alien bodies or non-human bodies, which would be logical, because if you have crashed discs and nobody in them, you have to wonder where they went. And so now what's the next step? The next step is obviously us, the abductees, because we are going to be in the hot seat. People are going to be looking at us very carefully. And what they're going to find is, well, that's something Les and I are going to talk about. And how the support community can help the close encounter witnesses bring this whole process into focus. Well, Les, welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you very much, Whitley. I really appreciate the opportunity to be with you today and talk about this very important topic.
Yes. Okay. Let's start by, Les, oddly enough, I was talking to him before the show started, has never been on Dreamland. And I've been doing Dreamland since 1998, and I could not believe that such a prominent abduction researcher has never been on the show. But anyway, this is Les's first Dreamland, and it won't be his last, I'm sure.
Thank you, Willie. Appreciate it very much.
You also have written a book, as I it is called The Unknown Other. The existential proposition of alien contact. And we're going to be looking at that and also some of the studies that have been done. But what I think the question I want to start with is, where are we now with the abduction phenomenon? Because when I get the information from other close encounter witnesses, it's really all over the lot. I mean, people are having such incredibly complex experiences, and they're so varied. So where are you overall with what is happening?
Yeah, I think, you know, when you take a look at the commonalities that occur with these people, it runs along pretty much the same lines, you know, as far as being taken through a wall or through the ceiling, being brought up on a beam of light, being on a table, being probed and implants being done, things of that nature, semen being taken, eggs being taken. But having said that, it goes, as you say, all over the place as far as how those things, you know, finally end up and the other factors that make this thing incredible. I mean, it's not just the grays, it's orbs, it's interdimensionals, it's time travelers, it's our military. I mean, it's all over the place. And I think that people talk about, you know, as I said earlier, the grays seem to be very dominant factor in all of this. And then orbs seems to be the latest thing that's going on.
Tell us more about orbs in terms of being the most recent thing going on.
Yeah. People are talking about these basically a light source, a very like pinpoint light source, which can grow to be larger. I've been involved with a woman that has done a lot of photographic work on these types, and she's blown up some of these orbs that she's taken photographs of, and it's incredible that you'll see a gray in the orb itself, like up close, and then you'll see a gray back further, you know, looking in a different direction. It's like a portal. It's like a portal that opens up. And this is fascinating, because we've been hearing about portals more and more lately, but the orbs seem to be a factor of that. And these things seem to also have energies that are sometimes helpful, and energies sometimes that are very disruptive to the human body. So it's all over the place. I mean, there's many stories about people being healed after a orb enters their body. And then there's other instances where it's just the opposite. They come down with an autoimmune disease. One of the latest books on skinwalkers at the Pentagon, they talk about that in that book quite a bit, the health ramifications of these things entering the body, yeah, or being near, right, the body.
People always ask me, or often ask me, why haven't you ever gone to the Skinwalker Ranch? I say, have you read the books?
I'm not going there.
Why would I go to the Skinwalker Ranch? No. I attract this stuff like all. I don't think any close encounter witnesses should go there.
I agree.
It's got something going there that's not necessarily good to take home.
No, not at all. The hitchhikers.
Let's talk about the ones that are positive and that are helpful, because this is really what we need to learn to bring into the world, because this has been a rough experience for everyone. I'm haunted to this day by the fact that my semen was taken from me. And because this is, as I say, this is my life. Sure. This is what I have to give. This is what I have to give to humanity, not to somebody else who took it.
Right.
And, you know, I've gotten past my anger and my fear and my disappointment and my confusion. And a lot of us have, because most of us, let me go to in another direction. Are you getting a lot of abduction stories? Because we're not on unknown country. Just recently, say a story some 2 weeks ago, say someone, I just got abducted. Is that happening so much now or not?
Yes, I'm getting 2 to 3 people contacting our site daily.
Daily.
They are
still happening.
Oh, absolutely. And then a lot of it too is people that have come forward, you know, in their 60s and 70s that have said, I can't keep this bottled up anymore. I've got to tell somebody that this happened to me, you know, earlier in their lives. A lot of this has happened starting at childhood in many cases.
I think the people who don't remember their childhood experiences, I don't know that it always starts in childhood, but I think it does a lot.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So
one of the things that I have come to think about more and more, and I think people will have a hard time with this revelation, is the fact that I think we've all had experiences, whether we consciously remember them or not.
Absolutely agree.
Wow, that's great. Yeah, I mean, and I'll tell you a little experience. In the early days of Opus, this is when I was living in San Jose, California. One of the support group meetings that I was facilitating, a person said to me, I've seen you before. I said, where, at a UFO conference? No, I saw you on board the craft. I said, really? No, that's really interesting. And so I kind of blew it off. And then a year and a half, 2 years later, a totally different person said the same thing to me. I seen you before. I said the same thing, you know, at a UFO conference. No, no, no. You were sitting on this bench naked. You were freaking out. And they told me to go over to you to calm you down. Well, at that point, I decided to go get regressed. And I had three separate regressions. And I found out nothing along those lines, but I had multiple past lives. And so this reincarnation thing seems to be a factor that comes up in a lot of these experiencers talk about the non-human entities, talking about the fact that reincarnation is part of the universal process.
Yes, that's certainly been part of my experience too. Yeah, I agree.
And so, again, after a while, I was talking to another person in the support group, and they said, well, maybe this person actually saw you in a past life that you were abducted. So it can be all over the place on this thing. You know, once you start going down this rabbit hole, Whitley, it has so many twists and turns that it boggles the mind.
Well, you know, it's very odd that you suddenly kind of out of nowhere brought past lives up, because we weren't even talking about that. But what makes it odd is I dreamed about past lives all last night.
Oh, geez. So
why did you happen to bring it up? Do you have any idea? It just sort of floated into the conversation out of nowhere.
Well, I think it was because of the fact that I think, you know, we were talking about people having experiences, whether they consciously remember it or not. And so that was my situation. But the outcome of that was that I had multiple past lives.
Well, my dream was not specific about specific past lives. It was about talking to somebody about past lives, which I am now doing. This is such a wonderfully weird world. I love it in many ways.
And yes,
because you know it happens fairly often on this show that we end up with something like this, or the weird coincidence, or you know, a synchronicity or something. And so this is fun.
Exactly.
Now, let's go back a little bit and explore you a little bit more, because this had to have started earlier. You didn't just sort of walk into MUFON one day and say, hey, I want to do this.
Right,
where
exactly.
Where did you start with this? I bet it started somewhere in childhood.
It did. It did.
I knew it.
I was 11 years old living in Connecticut, and it was dusk, late October. And I was coming back into the house after feeding my dog Caesar. And I saw this object off to my right. And it was basically an oval type object. It was not making any sound. It was whitish, silvery in color. And it was slowly moving along. And it scared the hell out of me. And I ran into the house. And by the time I got my father to come out, it was gone, of course. And he said, well, it's probably just a beacon of light reflecting off a cloud or something, you know. And of course, I didn't believe that. And so I went to the library shortly thereafter and picked up some books on UFOs. And of course, George Adamski was the big writer back in the late 50s,
right,
when this happened. And so I really got into it for a while. But soon thereafter, you know, became an adolescent, and girls became a little bit more interesting in my life, and kind of forgot about it, and went off to college, went in the service, got married. And in 1985, I moved out to San Jose, California, and picked up the San Jose Mercury News, and Stanton Freeman was coming to San Jose City College to talk about UFOs and the government cover-up. Well, that was like somebody threw a switch, and I said, I've got to go see him, and I did, and he gave, you know, one of his wonderful presentations, and on my way out, there was, in the foyer, there was a table set up by MUFON, the Mutual UFO Network, and they were talking about the journal that they published, and so I decided to get that. And after a while, that wasn't enough for me, and so I found out that they had a field investigator training course, and so I became a field investigator, and all the cases, almost without exception, were not only sightings, but people were telling me that they had contact with non-human intelligences. And I was kind of a nuts and bolts kind of a guy back then. This is the early 90s. And so I you know, those first cases, I was having a little bit of difficulty trying to grasp what was going on. But after a while, it became evident that these people were having something going on in their experiences. And one day, one of the people that I was working with said, "Did I know of other people?" And I said, "Yes, I do." And the next thing I know, I'm facilitating a support group with a parapsychologist that I knew that I thought I should have a mental health type of a person involved with the support group.
Yeah, very definitely.
And that went on, and I started to hear incredible stories. And one day, a writer from the Monterey Coast Weekly paper got a hold of me to do an interview, and he had contacted MUFON headquarters, and they had given him my name. And after this article came out, a woman contacted me, and this is where the story gets pretty weird. A woman contacted me and said, "I'd like to understand what's going on with my brain when I'm in contact with these off-earthly entities." And I said to myself, well, you know, I don't know how I could possibly help this person. Then she said to me that she was working with a emergency room doctor down in Carmel. And I said, "Really?" And I had a doctor friend, Dr. Eugene Lipson, who was very interested in meeting other doctors interested in the phenomena. So I convinced him, "Let's go down there. You can meet this doctor, and I can talk to this lady, and we'll see what's going on." So we did. And as we walked into her home, there was a picture on the wall. And this picture, she was standing on the back of a vessel, obviously in some kind of Caribbean waters. And I said, "What's this all about?" She says, "Yeah, I'm down in the Caribbean, and I was helping these treasure hunters." And I said, "Well, how were you doing that?" She says, "Well, I was in contact with the captain of the galleon that had gone down."
Wow. So, did she find anything?
So I believe they did. I did, but I didn't hear the rest of the story, because the rest of the afternoon she was talking to us about us, and there was no possible way she could know these things. And what had happened after a near-death experience, she became very psychic. And was able to, you know, all these things started to happen to her. And so we came away that afternoon, and this is like 1993. And we decided that we should come up with some kind of organization. That's when Opus, the Organization for Paranormal Understanding and Support, was hatched. And in 1994, we officially became a 501(c) nonprofit recognized by the IRS, which always cracks me up.
That's great. And folks, you can find out more about Opus on opusnetwork.org. And you can also look over Les's book, The Unknown Other, there, and also, of course, on our website as well. And you can let me just quote from opusnetwork.org. "I've had an experience. Now what?" Well, they're here. You can push the request support button, and they're here for you.
Absolutely.
There are other groups too out there that are here for you, but Opus Network is certainly one of them. Now we're going to take a brief break, free Dreamlanders, and we'll be right back.
Very good.
2 years in the writing, my new book, Them, is finally ready to go. It will be published in Kindle and as a paperback on March the 23rd on Amazon. Later, it will be published as a hardcover and as an audio book. Them is a departure. There is nothing like them. It is the first book of its kind, a completely new way of looking at the close encounter experience, a deep exploration of both the civilian and military experience of contact with the visitors, and both have been very profound. Much of this material is simply not known, but I go into it, I think, more deeply than anyone ever has before. I don't talk about my own experiences in this book, but rather about the experience itself. Them. Mitch Horowitz calls it in the preface among the most important interpretations of visitor phenomena since Jacques Vallée's Passport to Magonia in 1969. Dr. Velez says in his foreword, the book cites fact after fact to build the case for in-depth realignment of public policy and public need. Diana Walsh Pasulka, author of American Cosmic, says, leads the way, and it's best that we listen because the stakes have never been higher. EarthTech International President Hal Puthoff says, them is exceedingly valuable. Leslie Kane, author of UFOs, Generals, Pilots, and Government Officials Go on the Record, says, groundbreaking in the truest sense of the word. Bigelow Aerospace VP Colm Kelleher says, searing and masterful. Them, a new vision and a new way of looking at close encounter. You have never read anything like them before. It is the beginning of a new way of looking at our own future.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. UnknownCountry.com. There's no place like it in the world.
Okay, we're back. We're talking to Les Velez. Am I pronouncing your name correctly, Les?
Absolutely. Right on.
Oh, good.
Perfect.
All right. And you're talking about your own history in this, and I am quite concerned about what is apt to happen in the near future, because we go from materials to intact craft to bodies to what is happening to these people. What are these people all talking about? And I don't think the media and the general public are prepared in any way whatsoever. And I think that a lot of us are going to be under a lot of pressure. People are going to be ending up on radio and television, including people who have not had experiences and are claiming things that are not true, or believe that they have had experiences that they haven't had, or are very confused about them. And you add to that the fact that the internet, when Zuckerberg discovered that people click more on things that they make them angry or things they prefer and like than they do on anything objective, he created a very fundamental change in the way we think. And I tried an experiment on Twitter a couple of weeks ago. There was something on there, a very controversial documentary being circulated on Twitter called What is a Woman? And I thought to myself, I wonder what happens if I put up a tweet that is completely neutral on this subject. What will happen? So I put up a tweet. A woman is a person with X chromosomes. What a person wishes to be is their own business. Could not be more neutral than that.
Mm-hmm.
Both sides screamed madly that I was against them. Now, you can't think that way and handle something as ambiguous and difficult and powerful and frightening as the close encounter experience. But that is the way people have been taught to think by spending too much time on the internet. So what are we going to do? I think we all have to band together, all of the different groups, the people. There's got to be a consensus among us. And how do you react to these statements?
Absolutely, Willie. I totally agree with you. I think that the floodgates are going to open, and it's going to be dramatic. One of the things that we've been trying to do now is bring on more mental health practitioners, more hypnotherapists to work with these people. But as far as the social media, it's been one thing, you know, there's a good part of it, and then there's a bad part of it, and as you just brought up. And it's tragic because so many people can be hurt by this. And, you know, all these experiences that people are having, certainly in the beginning stages, they're quite stressful. Thank goodness most of the experiences, the majority after a number of experiences, turn out to be a positive, more of a spiritual journey.
It's exactly what happened to me. I agree.
Yeah. Yeah. And then you still have a percentage like 20-25% that are still having a terrible time, absolutely terrible time. And it's basically, it's like here on Earth, we have good people, we have bad people, but the same thing is going on with these entities. We have some good ones and then we have some bad ones.
Right. Well, that would be true if we went to another planet too.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, there'd be some trolls and creeps, and also some good people, a lot of good people probably.
Right. Right.
But they would be subjected to all, and they'd be trying to think of us as a single sort of entity. And I think that's a grave mistake. I think we're dealing with a lot of individuals here.
Yeah, exactly right. Exactly right. And you know, there's some, you know, like the Bud Hopkins and the David Jacobs are, you know, it's all negative. And then you have Stephen Greer that's all positive. You know, it's a mixture.
And then you have us in the middle, which are mostly the close encounter witnesses, are saying, hey, wait a minute.
Yeah.
Slow down. It's not that way. This is, we've got relationships, and I have a wonderful relationship with the presence now. Mm-hmm. I didn't always, and in fact, I got into trouble with it about a year ago while I was writing my last book, and it wasn't unusual trouble. I mean, I've gotten into trouble like that with people with regular people all my life. I have a tendency to do things that piss people off, and I pissed them off, and it got real scary because it was really weird. So I left the country and I went to England.
Oh, wow.
Because I couldn't work in this apartment. It was just impossible because too much strange stuff was happening.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you can't write a book in a place where it's just jam packed with poltergeists and stuff. You know, you can't do it.
Exactly. Exactly.
I want to go down another path now, and we're going to get back to the orbs a bit because I think that's very important. And also, I want to bring up hybrids in a while, but I want to go down a slightly different path now. And I want to talk about the evolution of the experience because back when I started in the 80s, it was total negativity. Bud was terrified and David was terrified, and they had good reason to be. I'm not disputing that at all. I was terrified because I was listening to them, all these people telling me stories about what happened to me. And it was not fun.
No.
Now, how do we reconcile that with the way it evolved? Because I now would not trade this for anything. I'm so glad I'm in this. And I think to myself, well, what happened to my semen? Was there someone born somewhere? Mm-hmm. How is their life? Do I have children I don't even know?
Sure.
And should I, is this Stockholm syndrome, Les? Mm. Or is this a valid emotional position?
Well, First of all, as I mentioned earlier, I believe this is a spiritual journey that you grow through this process. And then when you stop having contact, it is like the Stockholm syndrome, because people start to wonder why did it stop? Now, why aren't you coming back for me anymore? And so it's, we don't have all the answers. That's the big problem. And there's a lot of conjecture about what this all means and why it's happening, but I think it's a process. We're just not at the top of the food chain. And this is a process that's been going on for eons. It's universal. And this is how we grow. This is how we evolve. Some of the studies that have been going on, like with Gary Nolan and looking at the brains of people in the area between the caudate and the putamen, where there's a lot more connections with people that have these psychic abilities and telepathic capabilities, and these people connect with one another very easily. And if you don't have that capability, it's probably not means the end of your family tree, so to speak.
But the thing is, though, that people are going to, there's going to be a time when everyone wants to be an abductee and everyone wants to be a hybrid. Mm-hmm. That's already happening to an extent. If you go on TikTok, you'll find people are talking about being hybrids, but they don't know whether or not they're hybrids. I've met hybrids who were fluently telepathic. Mm-hmm. Let me put it that way. And I mean, when you were around them, they were in your mind and you knew it. It was not hard to tell at all. And then people tell me they're hybrids and that doesn't happen. So are they really hybrids? I don't know. But there are hybrids out there, I'm sure.
Yeah. And David Jacobs is one of his books, he talks about hybrids. That these entities are looks just like you and I. You can't tell them apart. They've perfected the process, evidently, in a major way. And so, is this something that is malevolent, or is this something that is meant to, evolve us?
Can we make it work for us, even if it doesn't basically care to do that?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
One of the letters in my new book, Them, is an incredible letter, but it's not an unknown thing. This guy was a soldier in Germany or somewhere. He doesn't say where. Mm-hmm. And he moved to off-base housing, and a girl who lived downstairs became interested in him. And, he was rather surprised because... that doesn't usually happen. I mean, when I was a young man, it never happened except when I didn't want it to. But in any case, so they hit it off. They play backgammon together. They have a great time. Eventually, it ends up they make love. And after that, she wants nothing further to do with him. And of course, it's very emasculating to him because he thinks, she falls in love with me until we actually make love. And then she's gone.
Yeah.
But she called him and told him to come down to her apartment. And he said to himself, okay, she's officially going to say it's over. So she says to him, sit over there. And she sits under a light. And she says to him, I'm going to show you something. And then you're never going to see me again after tonight. And he's mystified. Whereupon, before his eyes, she slowly turns into a gray and then back into the young woman. And
that's pretty disturbing.
Hell, I mean, you say they look like us, but I mean, who in the world is walking the streets? I mean, we're going to have the most asymmetrical invasion you can possibly imagine. I mean, I was flabbergasted by that story, and it's not the first time I've heard it.
Shapeshifting is part of the process, evidently, that they're able to do those kind of things. It's scary. You're right.
Well, exactly. And how are we going to cope, Les? I mean, you're working with people who are actually beginning to cope fairly well, but what if what would you do if you're sitting across from an abductee and they slowly turn into a gray and then back into a human being? Then where do you go with that?
Yeah, it's, well, you'd say, wild. You know, what's your name? Really? Right. Yeah. I mean, these are the things that numbs the mind, you know, as far as trying to figure out which direction you want to go. And there's some things that we need to be very concerned about, too, because now you're going to, you know, we have people in this country, I'm sure around the world, that would shoot first and ask questions later.
Oh, and, yeah. I think our military may have already been doing that.
Yeah. So it's you know, that you could just multiply that by all the people if the revelation comes out. Well, yes, you know, these people are dealing with the non-human intelligences, and we need to check them out to make sure that they're not aliens.
Listen, I've been there and done that. Believe me, I had some people in the intelligence community back in the 90s decide that I was an alien. Mm. And I had a hell of a time. I mean, I had to finally call a guy in in one of the Senate intelligence committees that I was involved with at the time, and to say to him, get these people out of my street, because I lived on a little short street. Mm-hmm. And they'd filled the whole street with these cars from with license plates from Ulster County. I called a detective about it, and he said, well, those license plates are all government. Those are all government cars. And that's why I called the guy only. And then mm-hmm. after I talked to the guy about 15 minutes later, all the cars left. But damn, I mean, what mm-hmm. the hell do they think they are? Is going on here? One of my fears is that the people behind the scenes might all be crazy, that they've already been driven crazy by this.
Mm. Yeah, it's a distinct possibility. It's a real, I don't know, phenomena mess. Yes, that's yeah. That's a good word.
You know, I think us experiencers and all of you who thank God work with us and are good people are going to have to circle wagons pretty soon, because I can't imagine how this is going to go down. Another problem is that I was talking to a lady the other day who's really brilliant. One of the smartest people I've ever known. And, you know, she's a young kid and, you know, just unbelievably successful in business and just a very cool person and probably an experiencer, although that's never come up. And I was telling her about this story in the Atlantic Monthly about the David Grush thing. And it's very disparaging. You know, they can't handle it. And there's an article in the New York Times and they obviously can't handle it. And she said, that's because it's competition for them. These are people at the top of the food chain. These are the intellectual leaders and the elite. And they're feeling, Whitley, they're intimidated. And they're going to get very mean. And they're going to get very dangerous. Mm-hmm. So don't forget that.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I thought so, too. I thought it was very insightful, the word competition. And what we have to do is we have to say, this isn't competition. This is a journey.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely a journey. Yeah. A spiritual journey that we're on. Absolutely.
Tell me about your spiritual journey.
Well, it's, you know, this has been, talk about synchronicities and things like that, how where I've gone through all of this. Certainly, you know, from the beginning, I was basically just a nuts and bolts kind of a guy, just really interested in how do these things operate, you know? And who's driving these vehicles and things of that nature. But after talking to these people that are having these experiences, which are phenomenal, you know, people being taken and come back with healing capabilities that they never had before. I was talking to Robert Salas and his wife at the MUFON symposium a couple of years ago in Las Vegas. And I had done a presentation to an experiencer group, and they were in there, and they came up to me afterwards and said, can I speak to you? And found out that both of them together were abducted, and that she came back with this healing capability that she never had before. So for me, healing capabilities, psychic abilities, telepathic abilities, so many different things have opened up my eyes, my brain, to accept a lot more than it ever had before. And what we found out in so many cases, it predominates, is that they come back with a worldview change. And my worldview has changed as well. You know, we need to be better stewards of the planet. We need to be more loving. We need to be better to one another. These are all wonderfully positive things that people are talking about after they had these experiences. And I've, you know, again, consciously, I don't recollect any of those, but I've been put into this position. This is my mission, to help people and try to give them solace and understanding as best we can at this point, what little we do know. It gives me super gratification to get these people that come back and or write me and tell me how much, you know, they appreciated what we've done for them, and that it's helped them be able to move on in their lives and not get so bogged down in all of this. So that I don't know if I answered your question.
I think you explored the question beautifully, and you know what it made me think of? Made me ask a question of myself, and I'm going to ask it of you. Where did your compassion come from? You're a very compassionate human being.
I think it's your upbringing. I really do. I think that you're influenced by what goes on in your family. My parents had a kind of up and down kind of a relationship, and I always managed to get in between, you know, the times when it was a bad situation, so to speak. And whether or not that was something that made me the way I am today, probably did.
Yeah, I guess it did. Well, listen, those of you listening on the free side, we're going to take another break, but these commercials are very cool and they're fascinating and fun. And you really should do what we're going to ask you to do, which is basically buy my books, buy Les's book, and go to opusnetwork.com
org.
I'm so sorry, opusnetwork.org, and join Unknown Country too. And if you are an experiencer, Opus is a place to go. There's lots of them, but they're not lots. There are three or four good places, I think. Is that right? There's the experiencer group is a good group.
Mm-hmm.
Opus is a good group. I don't think, is there anything else really out there?
Well, you know, there's the MUFON has a group now called the ERT, their experiencer research or resource team, which
yeah,
I'm
they
actually,
changed it from experiencer research recently to experiencer resource team. That's right. Kathleen Martin's group.
Right, right.
Kathleen is so cool. I love Kathleen.
Yeah.
We're gonna take the break. I'm forcing Les. We want to talk. We're taking the break. We'll be right back.
2 years in the writing, my new book, Them, is finally ready to go. It will be published in Kindle and as a paperback on March the 23rd on Amazon. Later, it will be published as a hardcover and as an audio book. Them is a departure. There is nothing like them. It is the first book of its kind, a completely new way of looking at the close encounter experience, a deep exploration of both the civilian and military experience of contact with the visitors, and both have been very profound. Much of this material is simply not known, but I go into it, I think, more deeply than anyone ever has before. I don't talk about my own experiences in this book, but rather about the experience itself. Them. Mitch Horowitz calls it in the preface among the most important interpretations of visitor phenomena since Jacques Vallée's Passport to Magonia in 1969. Dr. Vallée says in his foreword, the book cites fact after fact to build the case for in-depth realignment a public policy and public need. Diana Walsh Pasulka, author of American Cosmic, says, leads the way, and it's best that we listen because the stakes have never been higher. EarthTech International President Hal Puthoff says, them is exceedingly valuable. Leslie Kane, author of UFOs, Generals, Pilots, and Government Officials Go on the Record, says, groundbreaking in the truest sense of the word. Bigelow Aerospace VP Colm Kelleher says, searing and masterful. Them, a new vision and a new way of looking at close encounter. You have never read anything like them before. It is the beginning of a new way of looking at our own future.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. UnknownCountry.com. There's no place like it in the world.
Well, we're having a great time today with Les Velez, opusnetwork.org, talking about the abduction phenomenon and what is about to happen to the abductees, God help us all, as this thing bursts into public view, because I think we're so very close to there being an admission on some level that there are bodies. And the next thing is going to be, well, what about the abductees? You know, I know Chris Mellon quite well, and I'm a friendly acquaintance. I wouldn't say I'm like an old friend. Oh, we've known each other for 50 years. I've known him for a couple of years, and we've had dinner together, and he's a good guy, but he won't interview on my show. Hmm. And the reason is that he does not want to identify himself with the abduction phenomenon and with the close encounter phenomenon and have to start answering questions of what do you think about this. Mm-hmm. And Lou Elizondo is in this exactly the same position, and I agree with them completely. I think that they don't belong on my show or any of the shows of being run by close encounter witnesses, because it opens them up and forces them into answering questions about something that they probably don't know about. And if they do know about, they certainly don't want to answer the questions. And here's the problem. I know the Air Force and the CIA have known about the abductions for a long time. One of the first things that happened after Communion came out was a Central Intelligence Agency man, David Webb, who was also a high-level guy in space sciences, befriended us and started coming out to the cabin. And he was a great guy. He was a lovely guy, and we had a wonderful time together. But he was frank about the fact that there was an awareness inside that this was happening. Now, this has happened. They obviously couldn't or wouldn't do anything about it. But did you hear I don't know if you heard David Grush's interview, there was an implication that there may have been some kind of an agreement with this presence, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. Have we been given to them, do you think?
Well, I think certain people have been given to them. I mean, you know, it goes back to the Eisenhower administration, supposedly, that they did make some kind of agreement with exchange of technology and you can abduct so many people. But of course, it went sideways and they started abducting everybody. Yeah, abducting everybody.
I'll never forget this. I said, you have no right to do this to me. Mm-hmm. And the answer was very prompt. We do have a right.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah. Was it that agreement or was it some kind of soul agreement?
Yeah. I mean, you've heard things about like that in the past where, yeah, you've made some kind of agreement in a previous life even or something. And, you know, now this is, you got to pay up now. So we're going to be taking you. It's so complicated, you know, and there's so many possibilities of this kind of thing going on. I mean, retired Israeli general that wrote a book, his name was Haim Ashed, I believe, and yeah. He said, yeah, we are in cahoots with these people, you know, there's bases on the moon, Mars, but they don't want to out themselves yet because we're not ready, you know, and so, but I think something's going to come about. I interviewed, and I don't know if you've ever interviewed John Ramirez.
Oh, yes, I know John, and he's been on the show a couple times.
Oh, good. So he's saying right now that there's going to be some major revelation from people that have stars on their shoulders, talking about the fact that, you know, we're not alone and that this is supposed to happen sometime between Labor Day and Thanksgiving, although I just talked to him last week and now he's upped it to probably October, and the way things are going now I think it's going to be even sooner.
The visitors always said to me that when the planet gets into an irrevocable crisis situation, we're going to emerge, and I think that they are scared that there could be an outbreak of nuclear war at any time. Mm-hmm. And also that we're losing the planet as a viable environment.
Exactly. And that's come up in the support group, which I monitor daily, that they're starting to talk about these kind of things, you know, crises and nuclear war and things of that nature. So I hope not.
Well, you know, they're awfully, the grays especially are really testy. I have only met the grays and in various forms, and I've also met the Nordics once or twice, and who were much more benign, I would say, or much less, more passive almost. Mm-hmm. But the grays I've known for a long time, and they're definitely very testy. I think that they're, if they show up, I don't think it's going to be a whole lot of fun.
No.
What do you think would happen?
Well, you know, that's a good question. I mean, so first of all, you know, what are they? You know, this biological robotic combination of some sort. They seem to do all the dirty work when someone has an experience. It's almost like all the different entities utilize grays. I mean, when you hear a person being brought on board a craft, you'll see the grays, of course, that they probably brought that person on board the craft. And then there's a tall gray, and then there's a mantid type, and then there might be a reptilian or a Nordic. And they all seem to utilize, it's like there must be like a universal store out there that they all go to and, okay, we're going to pick up a couple of these grays to go abduct these people because we don't want to get close to the humans because they're very warlike and they're very, you know, nasty and or can be. And
they're like hornets.
Yeah, exactly.
Man, exactly. Is hornets, and they are in fact hornets, big hornets.
Big hornets. But it's your guess is as good as mine as far as if this thing really opens up totally and what they have in their mind as far as what the next step is.
The grays are so negativistic that the way to get rid of them is not to say, get out of my life. That's how to get them deeper into your life. What you say is, I love you. I want you in my life. They're gone. I've heard that more than one time. Uh-huh. Let's get back to the orbs. And you were just starting to talk about them a bit ago. And you talked about an orb going into somebody. Let's talk about this whole orb thing that seems to be a new phenomenon or a new way of looking at it.
Yeah, well, these, you know, people have taken photographs of these things for many, many years. And, you know, people were discounting them as, well, it's a particle of dust, you know, in the camera lens or something like that. But of late, it seems like it's starting to happen more and more. Like I said, the second thing that people are talking about are not only the grays, but the orbs as being a definite factor in their experiences. And I don't know why that is occurring. You know, what's causing that to be? You know, years ago, it was just like basically one thing, a saucer shaped craft. And now we're into all kinds of different shapes. And the same thing now with the entities. They're all over the place.
Yeah. But, you know, something happened to me years ago. I was in the friend's backyard when I was still living in Texas and in San Antonio. And it was amazing. I was communing with my mother. I mean, it was like she was right there, and I was standing with my eyes closed communing with her. And someone took a picture of me. I was in the backyard at night. And when the picture was developed, this was before digital photography, there's an orb, and I'm looking, I'm like this with my eyes closed, and the orb's right up there, right there. And I thought later that orb, that was my mother. I think I was looking at a human soul, and it was my mama, and she was literally communicating with me. Could it be that these orbs are us?
Yes. And people have talked about that in the support group as well. And one woman actually had photographs of these orbs, actually a video of these orbs over her mother's bed, who was in the process of dying. And they showed up, and I guess the mother felt that that was relatives coming to visit. So that's another factor. I think that there's multiple, again, things that seem to be possible as far as what these things are. Like I said earlier, some kind of a portal. Some kind of a device that contains the soul, or it is the soul.
You also said that there was a face of gray.
Yes.
What if we are the grays? What if that's another form of human being?
Sure.
It's a wild thought.
Yeah. And a distinct possibility. I mean,
anything again, that's the wonderful thing about being dealing with this right now. All cards are on the table. Everything is possible.
Absolutely.
We don't know answers yet. But, you know, the media and the general public, they're not going to like that. That's like dropping them into the black hole of Calcutta or something.
Yeah, people want answers, and unfortunately, yeah, we don't have them. We don't have it's a lot of conjecture until we maybe pass on to that next level, and that's a whole nother process where people have near death experiences and have communion with these light beings that feel so loving. And they don't want to go back. And then they're told, oh, no, you have to go back because you have things to do. And and then they tell you things about your future that actually come true. So that's a whole nother rabbit hole, if you will.
Yeah. Both my wife Anne and the near-death experiencer Elizabeth Crone, who wrote the book Struck by Lightning, reported that they were told you can go back if you want to, but you don't have to. And wanted to go back, and so did Elizabeth, because it was both cases. And our son and his girlfriend hadn't gotten married, and she hadn't seeing her family started. And that's why Anne came back, and Elizabeth came back to raise her boys.
Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
Now there, I think we have some solid evidence about the kind of things that go on. But again, it's, you know, they talk about our field here that, there's no evidence, you know, what are implants? You know, what is that? And then the you know,
right. Roger, I'm wearing one right here.
Yeah, and exactly.
It works. I use it all the time. It used to be when I first got it, they first put it in. It was put in by people, by the way, but my listeners all know the implant story. I'm not going to go into it now. And I was like, it was like claustrophobia. I was just desperate to get it out. But my wife kept saying, don't do it, Whitley. Let's see what it's about. Let's see what it's about first. Mm-hmm. And I swear to God, she was the wisest advice. She gave me a lot of wise advice, but that was really wise, because now it's an essential part of my life. All the books I've written since 2015, when I learned how to use it, have been written using it.
Mm.
So.
Interesting. Yeah. So it's how do you describe the device then? I mean, what is it doing to you?
Oh, well, I don't listen. We'll talk about that off the air because my listeners have all heard that story.
Okay. But
just very quickly, it opens up a little rectangular area in one of my eyes, and words race past through it.
Oh my goodness!
And I have learned that these words will go into my. They are being drawn out of my own unconscious into my conscious mind. Okay. And it's like a muse or an inspiration machine.
Oh, wow. Very good.
It's really very useful. And it's a wonderful research tool.
Oh, wow.
I just wish more people had them. but I only know one other person who has one, and I'm sure there are other people who have them and use them and don't say anything about it, and people who have them and don't know that they have them and use them.
And one of the things we counsel people about is not to remove them. That we actually say that unless it's bothering them in some horrible way, we say, because if you do remove it, most likely it may be replaced. And it may be in a place that maybe not is advantageous, if you will.
I know a guy who got one in his penis.
Yeah.
He probably saw a few of those too. Those are people who someone put them in there. They thought to themselves, this guy is going to monkey around with this. He's not going to take this out. He's going to leave this one alone.
Yeah, I bet.
Yeah. So,
oh, my goodness.
Let me create a scenario. It's 3 years from now. It is now known that the abductions happen. And you are being inundated with people who think they've been abducted. A lot of them maybe haven't been. Some of them are seeking attention. Mm-hmm. Some of them are confused and maybe mentally ill.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them are real. You are overwhelmed with people. What do you do, Les? How does and I'm talking not about you personally only, but this whole community is about to receive a hell of a shock.
And there's going to be a lot of people coming forward after this is all revealed. One of the things, that we're trying to do now is to bring on more therapists, whether they're, licensed mental health practitioners and certified hypnotherapists. That's an ongoing effort that we're doing. But at the same time, you bring up people that are seeking attention, and we've started a group of our own, kind of similar to what MUFON started. We call our group the EST, the Experiencer Support Team, and these are people that have had a lot of experience. Not necessarily experiencers, although some of them are, to do triage with these people and to kind of weed out people that definitely probably are seeking attention or maybe looking for, you know, mental health type, you know, help. And so we try to be very conscious of that. And as you say, there's other groups like the Experiencer Group, now the MUFON ZRT, us, and there's a new group coming on online called the UAP Medical Coalition, and their charter, and I'm kind of one of the founding members of that one as well, where we're trying to educate the medical community as well as the mental health community in this phenomena. So, and we're trying to do more outreach. We're also planning to do some lobbying in Congress. Yeah, we're going to need a lot of help. We're going to need a lot of help.
I think we are indeed a lot of help. Well, free, those of you listening on the free side, we've come to the end of the your part of the show. And I urge you, as always, to subscribe and keep the site going, because it depends on you. We do not take outside advertising. Although I do advertise the books and activities of my guests, of course. Les, before we go, in order to avoid having to answer questions, what is that light that keeps going on and off in your place? There's a light that shines and it goes off, and then you push a button. What's going on in your?
You know, my screen seems to black out every once in a while. Are you seeing that? And I don't know why that.
The light changes. Okay, so it's some kind of an ordinary phenomenon, because I don't want people to be looking. What is that? What's going on with him? Is he going to get abducted? Or okay, great. No. Les's organization is opusnetwork.org. Opus Network does have room for you, and if you are interested in joining as an experiencer or as a support person, they are available, and they do have a program, and it's very sensible and it works well. And in addition, there's Les's book, The Unknown Other, a look at how Opus, the Organization for Paranormal Understanding and Support, came about to help people. And that is exactly what this is all about. This is a man, obviously a very compassionate man, who is there to help. And so, now, that said, we will have a brief moment of silence so that our sound guy editor can see where the free part stopped. Then we will continue on into a little deeper and more personal aspect of this.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.